Hi, this is Ramon, Peace Basement at the New York Comic Con first day, and I'm here with two beautiful Zenescope girls, Zenescope Comics, Zenescope.com, Grim Fairy Tales, Return to Wonderland, sweet books, unbelievable covers with beautiful women like this on them. Wow. Ladies?
Hi.
I'm Nicole.
I'm Jessie.
Are you into that kind of things?
Come stop by the booth and grab it.
Yeah, booth 1912. Come grab it.
Thank you, it was a pleasure.
It's nice to meet you.
We're here all weekend.
What's up, guys? It's Pete again. We're interviewing Greg Pak, proud author of X-Men, Phoenix Endsong, and Phoenix Warsong, which I don't happen to have with me, and also the previous Hulk story that you might have been reading. You should have been. Besides signing those. Actually, of all the stuff that you've done for Marvel so far, which would you say might be the favorite story you've written? Do you have a favorite story?
Favorite story? Probably Planet Hulk. I was insanely excited when they gave me the gig, and it was right up my alley, and I was paired with amazing artists and a great editor. And, you know, that's something that is really worth plugging. Editors play a huge role in this business and are kind of the unsung heroes, and having an editor that you really have a meeting of the minds with is solid gold. And Mark Paniccia was a great guy to work with on Planet Hulk and has been a great guy to work with on World War Hulk and on many other books that I've done subsequently. Planet Hulk just felt kind of touched in the right way from the beginning, and I just love looking at that big hardcover. So that's probably my proudest.
I have to remember to bring my hardcover with me tomorrow because it just came to lugging way too much stuff along with me. It's just the bag gets so heavy. Actually, on the note of editors, do you think that some of them may have a little too much influence? Like if you write something and they don't like it and they tell you, no, you can't do that. Have you ever had that experience happen to you?
Well, no. Editors' jobs are to help us tell the stories as well as we can, and just because we're genius writers doesn't mean we're always right. I really enjoy working with editors because even if when I get feedback, it hurts. It always makes the book better. You know what I mean? Because there are that everything. Everything always needs another draft. You know what I mean? Like the greatest thing ever always needs another draft. And editors are good at like helping us figure out what that next draft should be. They're also, editors also kind of need to keep their eye on the big picture, and they're looking at these characters in the long term, and you know they're protecting these characters for posterity in a way, and that's helpful.
I'm joined by a familiar face from the Watchmen series, Rorschach. Rorschach, how you doing?
As good as anyone can do nowadays.
So, seem pretty excited. Must be that Watchmen is finally getting a movie done. What do you think about that?
A sick, disturbing tale of groat, mutant people trying to work in this terrible world of intellectual, liberal, smooth talkers. I'm feeling very happy about it. Sorry.
You know, I totally agree on everything you said. You should run for president someday.
Now I'm here with Logan Parr, representative of Sega, and we're here to discuss the Iron Man, the movie video game. When is it coming out?
It's coming out day and date with the movie, which is May 2nd.
Wow, that's incredible.
Well, first of all, we're really excited about the game. Working with Marvel has been an incredible experience. We follow the movie, but the game is only about a third of what you see in the movie. So then beyond that, we expand into the Marvel universe, especially the rich Iron Man universe. So we got a lot of fan treats for the Marvel fans, the Iron Man fans, to really expand into that and make it a great experience to really become the unstoppable Iron Man.
Is it available for online play?
There is no online play. This is a single-player experience. We really wanted to spend the time making a AAA single-player experience and then really tying it into what happens in the movie as well.
Is it available for all consoles?
It's available for all consoles. There is a variety of levels that take you from the Stark Industries in the very beginning where Iron Man has been captured in Afghanistan to when he escapes, to when he discovers that his new objective is. The game itself is probably about 8 to 10 hours, depending on your play style.
Any hidden tricks, bonuses in there?
There's a lot of treats for the fans of the Iron Man universe. So there's a lot of suits that you can unlock. So you can have more than just the Mark 1 and Mark 3 suits.
I'm here with a familiar character. All you video game geeks might know. Right here, Lara Croft. Lara Croft, how you doing?
I'm doing all right.
So what brings you here to the comic convention, you know?
Well, I thought the Javits Center was a temple, so I just rappelled down from the ceiling and found myself here.
What do you do on your spare time besides, you know, coming to comic conventions and going into temples?
Well, in my spare time, I just made a really, really, really bad fan film based on the Blood Rain video games. Oh, I'm here premiering it, I guess. A very rough edit, but it's going to be on bloodrainfanfilm.com in its entirety in about a week. So we actually decided to make it just as bad as the movies, but it actually follows the game I Fight Nazis.
Awesome. Hey. If Captain America can do it, I bet you could do it too.
Here's the funny thing. I'm missing 3 minutes of footage, and there's a little bit where I actually do bump into Captain America.
How awesome. Look at that.
The footage.
So, being that we're here at Comic-Con and, you know, it's all comic book related, are you an actual comic book fan?
My favorite character of all time, and this is what got me into geekdom in the first place, was Lobo's paramilitary Christmas special. After that, I bought every single Lobo book ever made.
Ever made?
Ever made. Do you know that there's a fan film, a live fan film with
Lobo? With Lobo? No,
Lobo's
I didn't know.
Paramilitary Christmas special.
Are you in it?
No.
Nah, your agent didn't get you the job, right?
My agent is terrible.
I'm here with Graham Fuchs. Executive producer for the new Spider-Man game that's coming out for Activision. Can you tell us a little bit about the game?
New York's been invaded. S.H.I.E.L.D. has declared martial law. They're a group downtown trying to evacuate people from the city. Luke Cage is up in Harlem trying to gather forces for a last stand up there. Kingpin is holed up in his fortress in Midtown trying to get his forces together. And it's up to the player of Spider-Man to decide to figure out how they're going to repel this invasion. This is an open world Spider-Man game. You can swing through all through Manhattan, which people love in the previous games. However, this is an all original story. This is based on the comic books, not based on any of the films, which has really allowed us a lot of freedom to bring in a lot of the elements from the comic books that, you know, we like as fans of the comics, as well as find the elements that really serve the mechanics of the game best. So it's given us a lot of freedom to kind of make the game that we wanted and, you know, make it a real fun Spider-Man experience.
That's pretty good. Now, as far as gameplay, like, is it a traditional, like, button masher like it was, like, with Spider-Man 3 with the combos and everything like that, or is it a new fighting system altogether?
It's a brand new fighting system that's been put in this game. What we really wanted to do was kind of take advantage of the verticality of the city. So you're going to be able to start a fight on the ground that goes all the way up the side of a building and winds up on the rooftop. There's wall combat in this game. We really want to take advantage of sort of the acrobatics and web crawling and wall crawling abilities that Spider-Man has and incorporate it into the combat system.
You got it. And you hear that? Fall 2008, a new Spidey game for all you Spider-Man fans out there.
This is Penny Dreadful. We're here with Molly Crabapple, an artist from Rockaway, Queens. We're going to ask you a few questions.
Well, I'm really into drawing what I call saucy Victoriana, which means, let's say, Victorian dames in hoop skirts and bustles, but also with their boobs out. And I guess it's a mixture of my own perverted mind, and I think Victorian England is a good metaphor for life in our brutal society today.
How about these eggs here? This is my favorite right here, them jumping to their death. Where'd you get that idea?
It's a take on life. You see, all those eggs, they're so happy, they think they're gonna have like this awesome flight, it's gonna be fucking fun, right? But no, they're all gonna die, they're all gonna be smashed, and they're leading each other along, ready to perish. It was very tragic. I cried when I did that.
That's horrible. This comic is something that you only drew, or did you write this comic as well?
I wrote it with my best friend, John Levitt, and I drew it with a lot of input from him. So it's really a collaboration with John.
Awesome. And what kind of stuff do you sell? And do you sell them on your website, or what other projects do you have coming up?
Well, I sell prints, buttons, mirrors. I sell a fantabulous piece of art monkey jewelry. I designed it. It's super fancy. And pages from my comic book, t-shirts, all manner of weirdness, I sell it.
Hey, we're here at Greg Horton booth over at Artist Alley in New York Comic Con 2008, and I'm here with Jay, who happens to be stopping by wanting to get a cover done, a Secret Invasion, a blank cover, which is sweet, brilliant. I don't know why I didn't think about it. But anyways, Jay did, and what do you think about Secret Invasion so far?
I think it's pretty good. I like the whole fact they brought 70s superheroes back into the story. That was probably my favorite part of the comic. They got some twists. I see some good surprises coming out of the book.
Anything you didn't like about it?
You know, it's a little out there. A few things are unexplained. They got to get to the point quick because, you know, there's a whole lot of, going on. So, but I think it's going to turn out pretty well.
So, yeah, the Greg Horn table, I'm assuming you're a fan?
Big fan of Greg Horn.
Oh, isn't his stuff gorgeous?
I see pretty much every show he's at, I'm at his hands.
Really?
Getting something.
All right, man. I hope that cover works out for you, man.
Thanks, man. Appreciate it.
All right. And here's the man himself, Greg Horn. Hey, Greg. Ramon from Peace Basement.
Hey, Ramon. Nice to meet you.
I remember meeting you last year, and I said your stuff was just brilliant, and damn it, it still is.
No,
we all agree. Your stuff's just beautiful. Is there any favorite stuff you do?
I enjoy pretty much everything I've worked on. If I had to pick a favorite, I really liked Emma Frost. Miss Marvel is great. The interesting thing about all these characters is they all have different aspects to them, which, you know, gives you a lot of different opportunities artistically. With She-Hulk, you know, she's a strength character, so you're going to do a lot of things that involve her using that ability. At the same time, the book is a humor book, so you also get a lot of opportunities to come up with, wacky ideas and things like that. So, they're all different, really. It's hard to say I like one more than the other.
Now, personally, I wasn't a big fan of Marvel zombifying everything they did last couple of years or so. But this year, they're scrollifying a lot of their covers.
Right.
And, of course, you did these Who Do You Trust ads and whatnot, and they came out beautiful. And considering I'm a picky bastard, how do you feel about this whole scroll thing?
Well, these are the teaser images that I did for the scroll reveals, and from what I understand, these are all highly probable. So, I get the feeling these are the ones to look out for. But I'm one of those guys. I don't pass judgment on something until it plays out, because it usually turns out not in a way you were expecting.
So Marvel's keeping you in the dark about the Skrulls too, huh?
Yeah, they didn't give me too much information, you know. They just told me which ones they wanted me to do, and I was able to kind of logically figure out which I think are the real Skrulls, but for the most part it's been very hush-hush.
I know you do obviously do Miss Marvel covers and you're doing promo stuff, but what are you planning to do in the near future?
Virgin Comics is planning on doing a new Shadowhunter series starring Jenna Jameson. I've been doing those covers for the last year. I'm guessing they'll sign me up for that. And then I'm also doing the comic book covers for the 25th anniversary of G.I. Joe. So if you buy like a two-pack of the action figures, you'll get a comic book.
Any of this stuff like your favorite? I mean, you're young. Did you grow up watching G.I. Joe and whatnot?
Oh, yeah. Big G.I. Joe fan. In my youth, we used to shoot G.I. Joe guys with BB guns, and that wasn't a good idea because it breaks them. So now my wife had helped me relive my nostalgia, and we bought a whole bunch of new old G.I. Joe guys, and I shoot them with airsoft guns. See, so that's a good wife.
I'm jealous. You're talented, and you have a great wife. I mean, I don't know what to say.
But yeah, if I was going to say which one is my all-time favorite, I think I would have to go with this one. This is all the heroes at the movies, and you can just a lot of detail. It's a good conversation piece. There's a lot of things to see in there.
That's Old Hulk from the first movie. Have you seen the newest one?
Oh, no, I haven't seen the newest one.
Have you seen any of the images of it?
Uh-uh.
It's more redefined, more muscular.
Cool, I'd like to see that.
All right, thanks, man. Really appreciate it. And I will be stopping by tomorrow.
All right. Awesome.
Thank you.
I'm here and I guess a time zone that I didn't think existed here in the Comic-Con. I made a left turn and ended up in a time slip back in the Victorian ages.
I'm the senior editor for the Gothic and Lolita Bible, which is a quarterly publication from Tokyo Pop. Lolita is a style that's a popular Japanese street fashion that's also becoming more popular around the world globally. Here in the U.S., what's very popular is kind of more the classic styles, which is what you're seeing here. It is like Victorian, but it's different. It's what Victorian children or dolls would have worn. We have two, Lolita designers, U.S. Lolita designers with us.
What inspired you to design these clothes?
My mom loves Victorian stuff, and I was pretty much always around it growing up. And when I discovered this, 8 years ago, it just made sense.
For me, I really liked gothic fashion when I was younger, and I always liked cute fashion, but the two didn't really go together, and I found Lolita, and it was pretty much perfect. So I started designing the clothes because the Japanese clothes are all pretty much one size, and it's a very, very small size. So I wanted to design clothes for Americans so that they can actually wear the fashion and look cute, too.
Not to leave out the guy, too, because I know I would rather stay with the pretty girls, too, but we got to show the dudes, too. He looks pretty, dashing himself, too.
You wouldn't dress a guy in gothic Lolita. If you're a small Japanese man, you can manage it, but as an American man, it's very difficult to find classical things to look nice.
And is there a website to plug?
Several. GothicandLolitaBible.com. MeganMod.com.
BlasphemousCloset.com.
I'm with GothicandLolitaBible.com.
You finally joined in the interview.
About to talk to Arthur Suydam. Of all of the zombie covers you've done, which would you say is your favorite?
My favorite is usually the one I'm working on at the present time. So I have no one singular favorite, but whichever one I'm working on present is kind of the one I'm real hot on.
Now, I actually own your art book as well, and I know you don't only do the zombie covers. Yes, I did. Yep. What got you actually into doing the zombie covers? Anything in particular interest, or they just called you up because they liked your art style?
Yeah, no, I'm an anatomical artist, so that's always been my interest, and the anatomical drawings of the great Renaissance artists were always of great interest to me. Those are one of the things that actually got me into comics, was the drawings of Da Vinci, Raphael, and Michelangelo, where they really peeled the skin back and they were drawing écorchés. And I took a sculpting class where I was actually sculpting anatomy, and I did a lot of work with cadavers at the time. So when I came to Marvel with some pretty dark stuff. I had done some aliens paintings for Dark Horse Comics, and so it just seemed to be a good fit, I think. And number one, it's really painted work, and there are only one or two guys really. There are only a handful of guys in the industry that really paint. I happen to be one of them, so there's kind of a shortage of those. And I happen, as I said, some of the samples that I brought to them were pretty dark stuff. So I think myself and the zombies were a good match.
You are obviously, in my opinion, the best one to do all these zombie covers, and I never saw the Tick zombie cover. That's great right there. I'm definitely going to have to pick that one up right now.
Got a one-page story inside by myself and Dennis Lukiewicz, and my wife Nicole worked on it as well. So
that's good. We can actually just throw that one right on the pile here.
That was a lot of fun.
One last question. Now, you started basically the zombie trend in comics, in the Marvel Universe especially. What do you think of all of the other Marvel, the zombie covers that are coming out? Do you think imitation is the best form of flattery, or you think...
Imitation is definitely the best form of flattery. So I don't know if they're imitating me or if they're just being commissioned by Marvel to do them, so I don't know which is which, but... But whenever I find artists are influenced by the work that I do, I find it very flattering.
We still think that you are the best one, just whether they're being commissioned or not. Thank you very much, man.
And I'm actually here with a bunch of people who've traveled from a galaxy far, far away.
We're a part of the Rebel Legion. If you ever heard of the 501st, we're the sister group. We represent the good guys.
So you have a website and everything to promote here?
Yes. RebelLegion.com. We do everything from cons, of course. We do community events, too. We go to libraries, hospitals, community events, parades.
If you had the Force and you were laying on your couch and you wanted to change the channel, but the remote was on the table, would you use the force to grab the remote so you could change it, or would you just get up and just grab the remote?
We'd use the force to change the channel.
If your girlfriend didn't want to have a threesome, would you use a Jedi mind trick to try to convince her into doing the threesome?
That might be against the Jedi code.
That would kind of be taking us down the path of the dark side,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah. You'd have to talk to Darth Vader about that.
I think that's why I'll probably be a Sith. Ramon's behind the camera. I'm here with Ross Condiff and Milo Ventimiglia. I have to say it in Spanish because I'll mess it up if I say it in English.
No worries, man.
Now, y'all both working together. Y'all have a production company, Divide Productions, yep. Right? And y'all both, this is your first comic endeavor?
It is. It's our first comic, but, you know, we basically had the script in our stable that we always loved the story, thought it was great, and ultimately pitched it out to Devils Do. And they said, hey, that would make a great comic. And it's pretty much where we're at now, just, you know, making a kick-ass comic.
Now, were you always comic book fans, or did you get more into it after the heroes, or did you get into after the
heroes? Yeah. I just love reading, so.
Yeah, I was a pretty big comic fan growing up. My dad would always take me to, like, the local comic shop and, you know, sort through the bins and find some cool stuff. But, you know, Heroes, like, definitely kind of gave more of that entrance, too, as to doing a project like this, you know, linking up with Devils Do, making a comic, you know, with a great story and cool characters. So, for me, it was just, and for us, it was a natural progression to things that we'd already been into.
Now, who would you say would be one of your favorite comic book characters back in the day or even now?
Back in the day, Batman. This guy's a big Atom fan.
Like Atom or Aquaman.
Oh, you actually like Aquaman? Well, you're one of the very few in the world.
I was a Submariner fan. I like the Submariner.
At least Submariner's a little more manly than Aquaman.
Yeah.
How different is it for you to come here as a producer of a comic book than coming here for you?
Very different, but I don't think I'm going to be able to get away from the people chasing me for Heroes, which is a tough part. But it's nice to be on the other side, man. Finally kind of giving back to the community that reared me, you know, if you really think about it. A lot of the successes I've had on Heroes are because of the fans that are here at conventions, at Comic-Cons, at WizardCons, at any of that stuff. So to come back as a guy who's contributing to that, who's contributing to the world, that it's finally, you know, nice to have that sheet lifted off us and we're not just, you know, a bunch of people hiding in the dark reading our books. Like, you know, this is legit, good, great stories that we're all telling and reading. So to be a part of it, to give back to it, makes me feel really good. It's about a guy who takes an experimental drug where he doesn't have to sleep anymore. So imagine how efficient your day is. But then the downfall of that, if you can't sleep, you can't dream. If you can't dream, where's your life gonna go? And ultimately, you know, what a 24-hour world would be like, you know, the downside of that, because it is a very scary, real thing.
Also kind of explores if you were on the drug or if Milo was on the drug, kind of being awake for 24 hours a day and then kind of interacting with people that weren't on the drug, and kind of him, you would almost become like a superhuman being.
Yeah.
And it kind of, you know, we kind of ask that question, and it's kind of a discussing society and what kind of our society is becoming.
Now, did y'all write this together? Did y'all come up with this, the story plot together?
It's based on a script by a writer named Michael Sullivan, that script that we have at our company. And then we brought in, us and Devils Do brought in Mark Powers, who wrote Drafted and edited X-Men for several years. And we were just fans of his. And he was like, dude, I totally want to write this. We're like, that's great.
All right, so what was your inspiration to actually deciding, oh, let me do this, and let me take this script and turn it into a comic book?
You know, I think something that Russ and I always focus on is just great stories and great characters, you know, having these tales to tell. And, you know, it doesn't matter whether it's on the big screen, on the little screen, you know, on your mobile phone or in a comic. It's like you want to have a good story and tell people and get it out there. So this one just was a natural fit in the comic world, and, you know, see what else we can do with it.
And I'm here with a man who needs no introduction, but I'm going to give it to you anyway, Mr. T. How you doing, Mr. T?
Good, brother. First name, Mr. Middle name, period. Last name, T. How you doing?
So, Mr. T, what brings you here to Pity Fools at the Comic-Con?
I'm just here to have a good time, because I said, you know what? Don't give these suckers those statues. Give them comic books.
So, T, are you a big comic book fan?
Yeah. I love comic books.
Who is your favorite superhero?
I like Superman, but my favorite superhero is my mom's. I love my mother, because after mother, there's no other. My mother, you better treat her right.
Ah! Hey, you seem very excited to be here, and you seem very excited about liking comic books and Superman.
Excited!
You don't take any drugs, do you, Mr. T?
No, I just need more fiber in my diet.
All right, so thanks for talking to us, Mr. T, and I'm going to let you go on so you can keep putting in some foods.
Hey, brother, enough of that jibber-jabber. Give me this microphone. You better be good to your mother. You better stay in school. You better not do no drugs. Better not put me on no airplane either.
Michael right here is the writer and creator of Headlocked. If you're a wrestling fan and if you're a comic book fan, this is for you. Now, Michael, can you tell us a little bit about Headlocked?
The book's about a guy that's a theater actor. He goes to a wrestling show kind of against his will, and he's got a bad attitude about wrestling. But once he gets there, he kind of sees the sort of performance art behind the business, and he gets caught up into it, and that's what he decides he wants to do it. So he quits school, and he bulks up, and it becomes kind of like an obsession for him, and he puts everything he's got into becoming a wrestler. And the story's about him sort of learning the craft, and working his way up through the sort of the underbelly of the business to try to get to like the bright lights and the big stage kind of thing.
Seems good. I looked through it. The art seems really cool. I noticed that there was like some kind of stalker.
It's very hard to break into the business, and he doesn't. He's just a brand new fan, doesn't really know where to go, so he decides he's going to follow a wrestler, and he follows a guy after the show through kind of a back alley, and the guy, having been like a pretty hardcore heel, been stabbed a couple times, so he carries a knife to protect himself. So, and he pulls a knife on our protagonist.
Oh, if for those of you that don't understand what a heel is in wrestling, a heel is what they call a bad guy, you know, and a face is a good guy. So like I said earlier, if you're a wrestling fan and if you're a comic book fan, you should really pick this up.
We got Jerry the King Lawler supplying the cover for our next issue. We got a 3-issue miniseries hopefully coming out late summer. Jerry Lawler's painting the first cover. It's gonna look pretty sweet.
We have a new thing here with Prima Games. If y'all not familiar with it, Prima Games makes a lot of strategy guides for all types of video games. And now they're going into a new venture where now they're going to start making comic books based on video games. Now, can you tell us a little bit about this?
Yeah, about a year ago, we started carrying over some of our video game IPs into comics and graphic novels. It started out with Perfect Dark, which we ran in 6 issues. And what ended up happening is we condensed them together and turned it into a full graphic novel that's still available now. And more recently, we're getting into things like Army of Two with EA. It's our newest IP. Just came out. And we have about 3 more coming out this year.
Can you spoil it for us and let us know which 3 are coming out? Or is it like, you can't go there?
Can't go there.
It's a big surprise then, right? Now, where can we find these Prima comics? Anywhere, like in regular comic shops?
Yep, we're trying to sell them in regular comic shops. You can find them anywhere games are sold and in your local bookstores.
Is there a website you could probably buy them online?
Oh, yep. You can buy them at primagames.com.
What made Prima decide to do comic books?
We felt, we're all really big comic geeks. We play video games, you read comics. But we noticed that as we're sitting there reading comics and playing games, it's a bit of a crossover audience. So we figured, this would be kind of cool. We want to expose more of the world to video games, and there's some awesome IPs. They're great stories. So we can bring in some new people.
All right, one last question. Now, the comic books that come out, uh-huh, are the stories in the comics based on the stories that are in the game, or are they like an extension of like the game itself?
They are original stories, actually. So you're not going to be like playing a game and then reading the story. For example, Army of Two is kind of the prequel to the game. It tells you how they got together and some missions that they did before they started getting together in the game. Perfect Dark is also an original story that kind of runs between the original Perfect Dark game for N64 and then actually between Perfect Dark Zero, so it's a bit in the middle.
What's up, guys? This is Pete from Pete's Basement. I'm out to make one of my comic geek dreams come true. I'm about to get 2 copies of Amazing Fantasy 15 signed by Stan the Man Lee himself. And we're in line right now. We're going to try to hope to get an interview. So I keep making myself last in line. And as people keep piling up behind me, I keep letting them go in front of me. Because, you know, I figure this way I'm not a pain in the ass to anybody behind me. And they start throwing fruit and shit at me. Like, hey, move it, asshole. We're trying to get an autograph, too. So, I just let them go in front of me. So that way I can take some time and talk to the man for a few seconds.
And, well, wish us luck. At the very least, you will get to see him on camera, and he will be signing my books. And then they'll be back in 3 weeks from CGC. See you later, guys.
Whoa, lucky dog. You got your ticket?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
All right, so slide over.
Thank you.
Yeah, wearing the yellow T-shirt and the brown pants.
I have, can't say anything.
No, right.
Danny, no dice, but keep filming.
Okay. Okay. Thank you very much. Would I be able to get a picture?
Yes.
Go ahead, Greg.
Who are you with?
We are Pete's Basement, actually.
Pete's Basement?
Yeah. Comic book project. Think of us like the.
Got it.
Thank you. Wayne's World.
Good to see you. Good to see you too.
Again.
Pete, did you take my picture?
You got it, man.
Oh, man.
Where's
the camera's on this side.
Hey, next person with your items, please.
Got your ticket. Items out.
Thank you. You mind taking out your items? I don't want to mess with them.
This is the last guy, right? That's the last guy?
No, sir.
You're the last guy? Okay, all right.
We are the champions, my friends. And we'll keep on fighting till the end. We are the champions. We are the champions. No time for losers, cause we are the champions.
We don't got tickets. You have our, you have all our shit. We're inside. We are inside. We're waiting over by the... Where should we meet you?
Yeah. He was supposed to be in three.
Yes, Danny Sanchez is behind the camera, and you should all be afraid. It's a miracle he hasn't broken the damn thing. Look at him. He's grinning, too. You don't know the horrors I have to deal with. Help! Please, help!
All right. Thanks.
Take care, man.
No,
thank you.
Would you mind saying hi to my friend Amanda?
What's up, Amanda?
Yeah, that's off the hook.
That's, I can't believe that asshole did it.
Yo, it is two of them.
I can't believe he did it. That's awesome.
That's the best.
Where is he?
It's awesome and terrible at the same time.
Insanity.
Basement is a good place to be.
Kind of like the Wayne's World of comics.
Hey, how you doing?
How you doing?
How you doing, Danny?
I'm good.
Really? I'm happy to hear that, man. I've been here since 10. My feet are just flat slabs of raw meat right now. Dead. Dead. My feet are dead to me. Doop, 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 doop. Is it?
No.
No? No. Nothing? No?
No.
All right. Doobie, doobie, doo. Doo, 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 doo.
What's up? Danny here. Exhausted. Seems like it's going to be the end of day two here for us here at Pete's Basement. I guess show everybody here just lamping about because they're just like lazy and tired and exhausted. I should pass this mic around just like the clap and see what anybody got to say. Penny?
I'm so hungry and tired and exhausted. I've been here since like noon. I was here last night. I can see pizza like dancing on the floor in front of me.
They both get fat. The kids in Ethiopia, dude.
Hey, I'm Dave from Pete's Basement. And Comic-Con is the place where you go to punish your feet. Take that, 8.5!
Steve doesn't remember his name.
I've been here for so long, I've seen like 4 Batmans. 6 Riddlers, 17 Spider-Mans,
a billion ninjas,
a zillion cats, some real, some imaginary, and I think it's time to go home.
It's definitely time to go home. I just think this was so big that my head is about to spin, and I'm so hungry, and I want to go home. So let's just go home. Are we ready to go home? Let's go home. Let's go home.
Thank you.
Hi, everybody. It's just about 7 o'clock, day 2 at the Comic-Con. I'm tired. My legs hurt. My feet hurt. My head hurts. And I've been at this since about 9 a.m. today and yesterday. I have barely eaten. I think I had about a pretzel and a piece of pizza here. Somehow spent $30 on both of those. I barely drank anything. I've been running around like the proverbial headless chicken. And somewhere along the line, I spent $10,000 this weekend. Oops.
Hey, what's up? This is the other Pete. And I basically spent the last 2 days walking around, killing my feet, getting autographs left and right. And basically, bottom line, I just want to beat the shit out of Pete because he spent $10,000 to buy 2 copies of Amazing Fantasy 15. Ya fuck? But all in all, I had a great time and I met a lot of great people. So now I'm going to go home and burn my feet off because they hurt too much. Later.
Can we go the fuck home now?